They've been told to go for launch, Ed, and this is symbolic from a geopolitical perspective on who is on board.
Yeah, we'll get to the crew, but, you know, I think this might be a first for Bloomberg Tech. Have we ever carried a launch live? I don't know, but with 10 seconds on the clock, let's listen in.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition. Ignition's full power and liftoff. Go Falcon, go NASA, go Crew 11.
Together we rise as NASA's SpaceX Crew 11 heads up to the International Space Station.
Vehicle is pitching downrange.
1.7 million pounds
stage
of thrust.
Propulsion is nominal.
Propelling Falcon 9 as the vehicle pitching downrange and making its way up the East Coast, and will soon join Expedition 73 aboard the orbiting laboratory. So far, getting good call-outs on that first stage performance.
We are now T plus 35 seconds into the Crew 11 mission onboard Dragon and Falcon 9. The Falcon 9 engines
stage one throttle down.
Are throttling down to help
power and telemetry are nominal.
To help pass through the period of max Q, or maximum aerodynamic pressure on the vehicle during ascent.
Max Q.
We just had max Q right there.
Falcon 9 is supersonic.
One minute, 9 seconds into what is a little bit more less than a 9-minute flight uphill as Dragon continuing.
Stage one, Bravo.
So currently traveling 1,500 kilometers an hour as the SpaceX Falcon 9 with Dragon on top goes through Earth's atmosphere. It'll get up to around like 5,500, 5,600 miles per hour. When it gets to that orbital height, you're talking like 17,500 miles per hour. They called the moment of max Q, Caro, which is the moment where the rocket's under most stress. You know, from a G-force perspective, passing through Earth's atmosphere, that rough air that it passes through. But the next key moment is about, I don't know, let's say 30 seconds away. And that's where that first stage, the main booster, you have main engine cutoff, or MECO. And it's kind of an important moment because from there, you'll get the two stages separating. And then it's like literally fully automated. It's, I was going to say clockwork, but it's rocket science. And and it's pretty flawless most of the time.
And who's it? Mike Finke, who's the pilot from NASA, veteran on these three previous missions, we understand, managing to ensure that we get safely these people on board, these four crew members, up to ISS. So pretty integral moment. And we wonder just how their bodies are feeling on board right now. Can you just give us a sense of what it's like to experience this sort of force?
I don't know, because I've never been on a rocket. But no, it's immense stress on the body. We just saw that perfect shot of first and second stage separations. What you're looking at is the single engine attached to the second stage at the base of Dragon capsule. You raise a really good point, which is on the crew, and you asked me earlier, but we got interrupted by the flawless launch, frankly. But one of the interesting things about this is that the commander of this mission, Zena Cardman, she had been due to fly on Crew 9. She's now leading Crew 11, but this is her first ever space flight.
Wow.
And that's notable because the shuffle was caused, if you remember, by the Starliner program and all the different tests that kind of went wrong and the timeline slipped. But that's a really interesting and notable moment. We're about 3 minutes and 30 seconds into this sequence. The booster, as it falls down to Earth, we're not seeing it in shot right now, will sort of do its burns and flips pretty soon before it comes into shot. But again, as it stands, this is all nominal, Caro, as they say, which means everything's going fine.
Going fine for Crew 11 to then dock to relieve Crew 10 astronauts who've been on ISS for how long?
Many months, I think, since the spring. The idea is that there's a handover period, right, which is really quite normal. And they, you know, in order to get there, have to dock, and then there will be plans in place by NASA and SpaceX to bring the existing crew back down there online. And you know, like one of the good questions that you raised earlier and that people always ask in our coverage is like, what are they going for?
Mm.
And part of it is like, I'm repeating myself a little, but ISS gets decommissioned in about 6 years' time. You know, it's the end of the agreement. It's served its life. But in the interim, it needs maintenance. And so as part of the cargo or payload that's going up with Crew 11, there'll be materials to service the humans on board, but also like the scientific apparatus and equipment that's up there.
And let's just dwell a little bit more. You mentioned Zena Cardman, commander, and one of the few active female commanders in recent years. We've got Mike the pilot. You've also got Japan involved, Russia involved. This is geopolitics at work here.
Yep. So JAXA, which is the Japanese space agency, has sent Kimi Aoi. This is his second space flight. He actually went up into space 2015. And then this is the bit, right? There's the reporting that we had today that the interim NASA chief, which is Transport Secretary Sean Duffy, had met with his Russian counterpart. Because the context is, was SpaceX not around to do this? Then America, because of what's happened with Boeing and Starliner, would probably rely on Roscosmos, the Russian agency, to take American astronauts to the International Space Station. Now, in this case, there is a Russian astronaut aboard the capsule. His name is Oleg Platonov. It's his first trip to space as well. And away from whatever is happening in geopolitics and in markets, remember that the agreement between America and Russia, Caro, is longstanding. Mm. You know, the agreement literally to cooperate on not just ISS, but move astronauts from Earth into outer orbit in ISS.
Ed, what's so interesting is the dominance of Elon Musk's SpaceX here. Yeah. We also think about Japan being in the mix and indeed Russia, as you say, alongside the United States. It was but this week earlier, so much has happened this week, but that Australia didn't manage to get its rocket off the ground. Just where do we stand in this so-called space race?
So SpaceX, as a private company, but an American company, dominates the vast majority of payload to orbit, around 85 to 90%, including human and non-human payload. China is increasingly doing more. You will also remember that, like, there are other nations around the world. Some of the Gulf states, like UAE, have space ambitions. But it goes back to what we were talking about earlier, right, which is the economics of launch. As we see the booster on the left-hand side of the screen re-entering Earth's atmosphere, falling down using aerodynamics, but also the paddles at the base to orient itself and slow itself down. On the clock, by the way, I'm jumping around a bit, but we're 7 minutes in, and the kind of key moment is about 40 seconds away, where we should see that booster land back to the landing zone. But to answer your question, yes, SpaceX dominates, but there is pressure coming from both government sector-backed and private sector-backed rivals around the world.
And we're just losing some connection. There we have it. Will they make a landing? It's like art, Ed. There we have it.
Well, it's rocket science.
Art and rocket science at work. But just remind us, because we've just been so in awe of not only these landings and the reusable rockets, but the catch that we've seen in the next iteration of spacecraft coming from Elon Musk.
Yeah, so Falcon 9 is SpaceX's high-volume vehicle launch system. That's what we're looking at here with Dragon capsule on top. But they also have Falcon Heavy, which is used for basically higher density satellite payload. It hasn't taken humans. And then Starship's the next phase. Starship, the biggest rocket that humankind's ever built. And I think Elon Musk has said on X that the next full test of Starship is going to be in the next month or so. The mechanism for the Starship booster in that system is, as you say, not to land it on a landing pad as we just demonstrated with Falcon 9, but to catch it. And you know, we can't do this right now because we're carrying the launch live, but go on the internet and look at how that works. That bit they've kind of done. They've done it successfully. It's the ongoing spacecraft part of Starship that they're still working out.
Let's talk a little bit about economics here of NASA as well, because we just see the energy behind wanting to put money to work behind Elon Musk's SpaceX, and the rounds get larger and the valuation just soars. Yeah. But NASA itself is trying to do more with less.
Well, SpaceX has been at the core of that story, and it's something that started in the Obama administration. You know, again, the economics of space have changed. SpaceX has never disclosed the per seat cost. but you can do the math based on the disclosures that we do have. And it's several million dollars per person. Compare and contrast with what else has been out there from United Launch Alliance. And let me just catch this key moment here. Look at that.
As we see Dragon coast into its orbit.
And a wonderful view there is Dragon Endeavor with Crew 11 on board. Safe.
Dragon separation confirmed.
And safe in.
Dragon, chief engineer on Dragon to ground. Xena, Mike, Kimya, Oleg, welcome to orbit. On behalf of the entire Falcon team, we thank you for flying with Falcon today and wish you a great mission. Dragon will take you from here. Over to launch director for a few words.
So, Caro, what that was Dragon, the capsule, on the left-hand side of the screen. You see the crew inside there separating from the second stage. And now they're in orbit, right? And I'm just going to give you a quick statistic, which is very interesting. We were scrubbed on Thursday. 23 hours later, we did launch on Friday. But because of where ISS was lined up with planet Earth, for a layman's explanation, actually, what's going to happen is that, all being well and equal, Crew 11 and Dragon will arrive at the ISS at exactly the same time on Saturday morning, about 3 a.m. Eastern time, as they would have done if they had launched yesterday. And that kind of speaks to speaks to rocket science, doesn't it?
This view of space and analysis of curvature of Earth and speed at which we rotate in orbit, it sometimes works beautifully. It aligns, Ed, as this entire viewership has been seeing throughout the show, of what's happening currently live with Falcon 9 and how we start to see the astronauts now relieved. Now, just go back to the economics a little bit, because what we're expecting now is they are going to reach ISS. They're going to be relieving Crew 10. But in the future, will we see fewer astronauts on board?
Maybe. I mean, again, the movement here is for the private sector to build space stations. And so, you know, the cadence of that happening, who knows? This crew will be there for 6 months. NASA's thinking about maybe 8 months. You know, relieve Crew 10. They were there since March. They need to come home. But this mission's a success.